Sure, you saw on the package we're MIG welding some aluminum today. So I have a viewer who emailed me. He's been MIG welding steel for a while. It's going pretty well, but aluminum is giving him a lot of grief. I figured I'll go ahead and replicate his setup to the best I can with the equipment I have, see if we can't help get him going. And I thought rather than just going back and forth with him, let's loop everybody in and help, you know, just have a discussion about it.
So we're gonna start off with a baseline run like this and then work through some process development to get something functional like these welds right here. And throughout all of it, I used the same settings. So settings are not really the main concern here, but we'll talk about how to dial them in. So he was using the Vulcan Omni Pro 220 with a spool gun. Now, spool gun puts the aluminum roll right up by the drive mechanism and it feeds straight out, so you don't tangle your aluminum wire. Now, I'm not going to use that because of the wire that I have available. I want to use the same alloy, but I'll have it set up to work in the same way. So I'm using the HTP Pro Pulse 220 today, and I've put in some 035 inch diameter 4043 wire. Now, I get a lot of questions how I feed this through a normal gun. Well, I use a special drive roll and a special gun that has a graphite liner in it. Now, you'll notice this has an amperage control that I've installed on the gun, and I like this a lot because I can start off hot and then back it off a little bit as I make it through my joint, but I'm not going to use that at all today because that would be cheating and I want to replicate the setup. I had him verify his polarity, make sure we're on electrode positive and the negative goes out to the work clamp, in that he is running straight argon gas. I'm just gonna borrow some straight argon off my TIG welder and set it to 35 CFH, which is what he's running, and that should be reasonable for our setup. Now, as far as settings go, I've switched this over to straight manual mode. I'm not using any of the fancy aluminum settings it has at 330 inches per minute and 20.5 volts, which is what his Omni Pro recommended. And he's welding 1/8 inch aluminum, so I am going to use 1/8 inch also. Now, if you had dirtier material, it'd be a good idea to brush it with a stainless steel brush that's dedicated to aluminum and brush in just one direction. This is right out of the package, so I'm not going to bother with that, but I'll give a quick acetone wipe for good measure. Now, as far as technique goes, this is really important, so I'm using a little bit longer than normal stick out or distance from the contact tip to the work, and I'm using a push angle, so I'm pushing forward at a consistent length all the way along. Don't hold your glove that close when you're actually welding, but that just helps to film it a little bit. So let's go ahead and run a baseline right here. So I am using that push angle and moving along as steadily as I can. Notice how quickly I'm moving. That's one of the challenges when you move from welding mild steel with short circuit to welding with a spray transfer, whether it's steel or aluminum. Is you end up traveling quite a bit faster. Now, I'm a little bit wobbly there, but overall, not a terrible result besides that wobble all over. There's some soot around the outside edge. That just wipes right off and isn't really an issue. So I'm going to slow down just a little bit here, and we can look at the difference with those same default settings. So as I slow down, you'll notice maybe as I get about halfway through, it starts to sink down through the material. So I have a travel speed issue. The first one didn't melt through at all, and it was that small ropey weld. The second one was a little bit wide and burned through. So those are kind of the bounding boxes. One was too fast, the other was too slow. So let's just take another look here at that slower pass and look on the backside how it melted through. Now, something you'll notice is the start is quite a bit colder than it is later on, and that's the nature of the process, right? So aluminum heats up as you weld it, and so the settings you need at the end aren't the same that you need at the start, and you can avoid this to some extent by preheating or using some features that advanced machines have, but if you don't have that available, it's just kind of what you're dealing with in the nature of the process. Now let's go ahead and take what was learned there as far as travel speed and try to run one that's in the middle as far as travel speed goes. And right there, that looks like a pretty good bead. A little hiccup at the start, but not too bad at all. There's a heat signature on the back, so we did get a little bit of penetration, but didn't push all the way through. So you can see how sensitive this process really is to your particular travel speed. Now, I didn't change settings at all, but let's talk about what they do. Wire speed obviously changes how much wire is added, but it's the main variable that controls your heat. So if you need more amperage, turn up your wire speed. Changing the voltage will also change the heat to some extent, but the main thing to control with voltage is arc length. See, if it's too low, then you'll end up stubbing out. If it's too high, you'll end up burning back into your contact tip and you'll have a long arc that isn't controllable. Let me show you what that looks like. So here I've turned it down to 18.5 volts, which is lower than what we were running. And you can see it shorting out and you get a little bit of a short circuit transfer there, which is not ideal on aluminum. Sometimes on sheet metal, that's what you've got to do if you don't have pulse. So you do what you have to, but it's better to have a spray transfer like you see here with the 20.5 volts you've been running. So that's a nice arc length. It's a continuous weld and spray transfer just like you need. So that's what you're looking for. And if you don't have that, if it's shorting out, you might need a little more voltage. Now here I turned it up higher. Notice how long that arc gets, and it's very difficult to control when it's that long, and you can risk burning the wire back into your contact tip, and that just makes a huge mess. Like everything with welding process development, it really is kind of the Goldilocks principle, right? A little high, a little low, and then you find the middle range. So a lot of people will end up changing their settings over and over again when they're not going to get a result, and very rarely is it the settings that are the problem. So you may need to adjust your settings based on some of these principles, but make sure you do it with intention. Just don't go turning knobs hoping you get a better result. Now, it's really interesting to weld beads on plate if you're a nerd like me, but generally speaking, it's a lot more interesting to actually stick stuff together. So I've put a tack here on the corner of this T-joint, and we're going to weld it out here and take a look at how you'd run an actual joint. Once again, using those default settings of 330 inches per minute and 20.5 volts. So here I'm just running a steady, consistent stringer, and I'm just moving the puddle right along. I'm reading the puddle to the size that I want and adjusting my travel speed. Slower will give a larger puddle, faster will give a little bit smaller one, and less heat input like we saw there on the bead on plate exercises. Now notice here, when I get about halfway along the plates, they're heating up, and as they do so, you can see it start to melt and suck back a little bit of material from the bottom of the joint there about halfway through. So look at that there on the back. Now, if I want to avoid that, I need to reduce the amount of heat. And the best way to do that, like I showed earlier with those bead on plate exercises, is typically to travel a little bit faster. And so here I'm running just a little bit higher travel speed along with the same technique, slight push angle, 45 degrees into the joint, and I'm just traveling a little faster. It's gonna give me a little bit smaller fillet and a little less overall heat input. So notice it filling in, once again, those same default settings. Those haven't changed at all. Now take a look here at the result. And on the backside now, it hasn't melted through at all. And so this is, if I haven't hammered it home yet, this is really critical to understand that your travel speed has a huge impact. Aluminum welding is just so much more sensitive to that. So just because settings worked for one person, you may get a different result, not only based on slight variations in your machine, but just slight variations in travel speed. Now, if you aren't sick of watching me weld T-joints on a bench, that's good news, because I'm going to weld yet another one, because apparently I have nothing better to do with my Saturday morning. Now, here's a quick tip. If you don't have your clippers right at hand, you can just wiggle aluminum wire, it'll break right off. That's pretty useful. Now let's go ahead and run this one with a stitching motion. Now this works pretty well with spray transfer on aluminum, just because it transfers the heat out so well, and it can give you a bit of a rippled appearance. It can help to control some of that heat input and suck back and just give an overall even pace. And so I like to weld aluminum like this a lot of the time. It really depends on what I'm doing and the outcome that I want to have, but it does give a pretty good result. So that's just another option for technique. Once again, with those same default settings, 3/4 to 1 inch of stick out, slight push angle, and that's basically the recipe.
All right, well, it's a hot day out here, so I'm gonna wrap this up, but just real quick, if you are just learning to weld and you've been watching videos for a while, but it's just not clicking, or you wanna learn faster, check out my online courses. I keep them as affordable as possible and walk you step by step through the process to be able to learn what you need to without wasting any time. We'll see you next time.